For those of you who do not know me, Professor John Blevins, JB, I teach the cloud and big data course, and I just got named the faculty director for the Easton Technology Management Center. And the Easton Center, thank you. At the Easton Center, we are all about trying to support you and your efforts as students and, of course, do industry outreach. So we do a lot of these types of things. We want to bring on very high-quality speakers for you. We want to have the most amazing professors, whether they're full-time or adjuncts, coming in directly from industry. And we're also doing much more industry outreach. We're trying to create those opportunities for our students to find the best opportunities after graduation, as well as industry to come in and work with UCLA Anderson. So if you are here from industry today, I want you to think of the Easton Technology Management Center as your connection point with UCLA Anderson. So with that, let me introduce one of those great professors that I talked about. Professor Terry Kramer will come up and he'll introduce our speaker today. So, Terry.
JB, thanks very much. And let me actually just start out with a thank you, first of all, to the Easton Center. And also, where's Melissa Mills, who is one of our FEMBA students who works at Google. And she helped get this organized with the Easton Center. So just a round of applause for them to bring all this together. So as JB mentioned, I teach here at Anderson. I teach a course on technology management and also on the mobile industry, the innovation and evolution in the mobile industry. And later on, I worked in the State Department, which I'll touch on just very briefly here in relation to Vint. But you know, if you think broadly about the internet, what a fundamental impact on our lives personally and professionally. If you think about the information exchange, commerce, and more all this research that's being done on things like transportation and healthcare and energy, et cetera, and how it's been an enabler to solving big societal issues. You know, we're very fortunate to have Vint Cerf here, and his kind of de facto title and his legacy is going to be Father of the Internet. And as all of you know, with great things that happen, you have to have somebody that's got a vision, you have to have a series of enablers that kind of make that vision happen, and you need to have good governance. And Vint has been involved in all of these areas. So he was one of the original architects of the internet and a lot of the protocols that went with it. He's been a founding member of a lot of the organizations that have helped evangelize the internet and govern it. So former president of the Internet Society. He's also been the former chair of ICANN, who's been in the news a lot lately, internet naming and numbering. He's also received a variety of medals, including the Presidential Medal of Freedom. My own personal experience when I was at the State Department negotiating an internet treaty, Google and Vint were fundamental in talking about the benefits to society of the internet, not just commercial ones, but societal ones in terms of free speech. So we are hugely honored to have Vint Cerf here today, and please come up.
Well, I guess I should start out by pointing out that success has many fathers and failure is an orphan. Internet has more than one father. It has more than two fathers. One of the other fathers is right here, Len Kleinrock. So stand up, Len. In fact, if it were not for the fact that Len got the contract to run what was called the Network Measurement Center for the ARPANET program, a predecessor to the internet, I wouldn't be in this game at all. I came back to UCLA in 1967 to get a PhD in computer science. I had worked for IBM. I was working on parallel processing and trying to turn serial programs into parallel programs. But I got infected by networking thanks to Len, and that's an inescapable disease. You can never get rid of it. So when Bob Kahn and I started working on TCP/IP, which is a core protocol of the internet, that led to a lot of other things. But Len gets a lot of credit for having started this whole operation here at UCLA and persisting in it for a long time. And just want to make one other point. To those of you who think that the internet was designed 40 plus years ago and it must be sort of dead now, that there isn't anything new to be done, you would be wrong. And you'd be wrong for a number of reasons. The architecture was designed to be very flexible, to allow new protocols to be designed, to allow implementations to change over time. And to underscore that, I want to draw attention to some work that Len did back in the 70s and 80s, looking at flow of packets in these store and forward networks, trying to understand how to manage congestion. There's a guy who's now at Google, who's been in Xerox PARC and other Lawrence Berkeley Lab, Van Jacobsen, who has been very involved in doing work on improving TCP/IP flow control. And not very many months ago, he reread a paper that Len and his, I guess probably some of your students wrote, showing how to do congestion control in a rate-based environment. And a light bulb went on finally, 30 years later. Van Jacobsen designed a whole new flow control algorithm for TCP/IP based on Len's work. And that's now been implemented, and it works a hell of a lot better than anything Van has been able to do for the last three decades. So it's an example of the fact that even old technology can, in fact, be reinvigorated with ideas. So I invite everybody, as you listen to the problem space that I'm going to talk about, to imagine that you have some of the solutions in your heads, and I would encourage you to pursue them. So let's start out with a couple of discussions. Some people call these Internet of Things, they refer to this as cyber-physical systems. So I want you to think a little bit about what that might mean. Some people think of cyber-physical systems as, you know, robots that manipulate the physical world. And that's a very reasonable kind of model. You know, robots pick things up, move things around, assemble things, disassemble things. So they are doing things in the real world. But, you know, what about an automatic stock programming system? You know, stock trading system. Think about that. It takes information from the real world with the stock market transactions, does some processing, and then makes some decisions, and then takes an action which may affect the stock market, or certainly might affect your bank account if it's trading on your behalf. I think of that as a cyber-physical system, too, on the grounds that it's taking input from the real world and executing something and then having an impact on the real world. So that I think of as a robot as well. What about any programmable device? You know, how about massage chairs? We have a lot of those at Google. My wife bought one. She keeps it up in one of our parlor bedroom. I never sit in it, though, because I know that it's driven by software. And I'm afraid it's going to go like that while I'm in it. And so I don't sit in it. My wife loves it, but, you know, that's another example. So how about a light bulb? You know, is a light bulb a cyber-physical system? Well, it's certainly physical. When it has software in it, though, and it can be told, you know, turn on, turn off, change color, and so on, you're certainly on the edges, anyway, of the physical world again. What about JavaScript and Java and Python and all the languages that you find inside of web pages now? And think about the fact that that software goes from wherever it starts to wherever you are, because when you open up a web page, you're transferring a file of software, and it gets interpreted by the browser. So, I mean, it's like the browser is a virtual machine interpreting these high-level languages. That, too, could have real-world impacts. And so even that kind of environment may be arguably part of the real-world Internet of Things cyber-physical systems. What about sensor networks? At least they supply information that may drive the decision-making that has an impact on the physical world. And so even they may have an impact that's important to us, particularly if it turns out that their behavior compromises privacy. To give you a very dramatic example of that, 500,000 webcams were taken over by a botnet herder a few months back. And he used those webcams to aim their megabit per second video streams at one company, Dyn Corporation. 500,000 times a megabit is 500 gigabits per second of bandwidth being driven towards that one target on the internet. It wiped out Dyn Corporation's ability to operate, and that had cascading effects on the rest of the internet, because Dyn Corp was actually handling a lot of the domain name lookups and responses. So here's another example where something as simple as a webcam, not properly protected, becomes a thing which has a dramatic effect on the real world because of its abuse. So we should be worried about the fact that more and more devices with software in them and with programming or with communications capability can have an impact on the real world. Now, why is this a problem? Well, it's the software. You remember the Clinton campaign, it's the economy, stupid. Well, in this world, it's the software, stupid. What about updates or bugs? You know, first problem is that nobody has figured out how to write software that doesn't have bugs. We've been trying for 70 years, and it hasn't worked. We're just too stupid. We don't have the, seriously, we do not have the ability to understand the scope of our programming decision making. I mean, the states that our software can get into is often so huge that we can't imagine the edge cases. And so often we send this stuff out into the wild and it encounters, software encounters a condition that we didn't anticipate. Or we do something dumb. You know, for example, you might write a program that makes a reference to a variable in the program which never gets set by anything, in which case you have a random number to make a decision on and you branch off into, you know, some place in the code, or make a bad decision. Those are stupid mistakes, and what we need and what we don't have, for you computer science people here, is to think about software programming environments that will help us in discover those mistakes before they actually get into a product that goes out the door and has an impact on you and me. So building better software production tools would really be a big help. There's another issue, specifically with regard to the Internet of Things. Because of bugs, we know that we're going to encounter mistakes in the operating software. We're going to want to fix them, at least if we have any ethics at all. And so the question now is, how does that updated software get into the device? And where did it come from? And how do we know that when it arrives, it has integrity? That is to say, it hasn't been modified by somebody else. So we have issues with authenticity, with the source of the program, and with its integrity. We're going to have to think our way through that for devices that might be in your home for 20 or 30 years. This gets particularly hairy if it turns out the company that made the product goes away after 10 years and you keep the product for 20 and it has bugs. Who's going to fix them? Will they be able to fix them? Does anybody have access to the source code? You know, what are the legal requirements for a company that's making devices that we rely on for periods of decades? If the software has mistakes, how do we fix that? So these are not just technical problems. These are legal and corporate problems. And in some sense, we, you and me, suffer from failure to solve some of those problems, to create a framework in which they can be solved. There's another big issue here. It has to do with configuration of these devices. Most of the manufacturers of the Internet of Things probably have a very simple model. We're making a thing, and we gave you an app in your mobile, and you can control the thing remotely. Isn't that cool? End of story. Okay, you have a light bulb, it's a Philips Hue, which is actually pretty clever, and you can change its color and you can change its brightness and everything. And it's a great little demo for your friends. Look what I can do with my mobile. What happens if you have 25 lights in the, or even 12 or 10, and you want to control them? Okay, do you have a different app for each light? You know, that's starting to sound kind of clumsy. Or worse, what if you decide you want to use oral commands, you know, Google Home Assistant, Alexa, or some of the others. So you want to say, turn the light on that's in the, you know, well, how do you say which light you want? I mean, do you want to give them names? Frank, George, you know, turn George on at half, 50%. That doesn't sound right. How about turn on light number 47312A? Okay, that's copyright, not going to work that very well either. You know, engineers are really bad at user interfaces and names and things like that. The old joke is that if an engineer had started Kentucky Fried Chicken, he would have called it Hot Dead Birds. You know? So, definitely not our fort. So this configuration problem is very real. How do I introduce my mobile or my control system to all the devices I brought into the house? How do I refer to them? How do I maintain the software and so on? Here's an example. Suppose you had a house with 100 devices in it, and you move to a new house which also has 100 devices in it, so now you have 200 devices to configure to be part of your automated home system. Well, you don't want to spend the entire week typing IPv6 addresses into some application somewhere. We're going to have to learn how to help ordinary mortals scale up their ability to configure these devices conveniently and easily. And I think that for the most part, most companies have not really thought their way through that. It gets worse when you start thinking of many brands of these devices, possibly with different protocols and different kinds of naming conventions and different ways of authenticating yourself to the device so it knows you're the one that's supposed to be able to to control it. This could be pretty messy. And then when you get out of the residential environment and you get into a business environment, a manufacturing plant with tens of thousands of these things, it's clear that you need to have tools that will let you configure and manage these things at scale. I don't believe very many of the companies making these kinds of devices have even thought about that deeply. Well, you know, we talk a lot about artificial intelligence. My experience is that we managed to turn AI into the artificial idiot. And to give you an example drawn from the Internet of Things, I have a thermostat system that has two different thermostats in two different zones in the house. And it's designed to try to learn, you know, when I'm at home, when I'm not at home, and what my preferences are about temperature and cooling and so on. What these two devices learn is that I'm never at home. And so they believe that since we're not at home, that it should save energy. Therefore, in the winter it's freezing and in the summer it's hot. And at the end of the month I get a note saying, look at all the energy I saved. And I'm saying, yeah, I froze my butt off while you were, you know, dumbass. So, why would this happen? Well, part of the problem is that this particular thermostat system has a sensor at the thermostat. Now, one of ours is in the dining room, which gets used once every 3 or 4 months when you have guests, otherwise we're out in the kitchen somewhere. So it thinks we're never there. The other one is upstairs, you know, nice four-bedroom area. We don't go up there unless there are guests. That also is fairly infrequent. And so the thermostat up there thinks we're not there either. Now, the solution to the problem, obviously, is sensors all around the house that will tell whether there's anybody home at all, so that the system can share that information and recognize that it should be adjusting the temperature to your preferences. But it's an example of the sort of assumption that gets made of a single device, single location. It's the ensemble of the devices that count. And so people who are designing these things have to start thinking about multiple devices cooperating with each other, sharing information, and being part of an ecosystem that's serving your interests. Now, there's another rather interesting problem. What about the AI devices that learn the wrong things? Remember the chatbot at Microsoft? I forget the name of the chatbot, but it was up there to try to learn sort of the vernacular. And so the people out on the net figured that out and started teaching it all kinds of bigoted bad phrases and everything else. This thing started producing some really horrible stuff, and they had to take it down. So much for AI. You know, the machine learning is completely and totally dependent on the experiences that you offer to these algorithms. And so if you don't think hard about the kind of experiences these things are going to have, you'll end up with a device that learns all the things you didn't intend. By the way, this is also true of self-driving cars. I mean, they have to learn from experience, basically. And you present these cars with situations that they're supposed to learn from. And of course, if we have bad drivers, it learns from the bad drivers, and the next thing you know, okay, well, we hope that that doesn't happen. There's another problem with configuration. Suppose that you go into configuration mode with the 200 devices that you've got. When your system is in configuration mode, what if it discovers your neighbor's stuff and configures it into your system? Or worse, what if the 15-year-old next door configures controls your entertainment system for you because he figured out you're in configuration mode, so he launches his mechanisms. Yeah. We're going to have to figure out, especially in high-density environments like apartments, how do we make sure that when you're configuring your devices, you don't accidentally configure somebody else's and vice versa. Here's another example about access control. Suppose, for the sake of argument, that the house is on fire. And the fire department's on the way. The sensors know that the house is on fire. That's why the fire department's on the way. The question is, what should the fire department be able to do with any available sensors in the house? If you have webcams, for example, shouldn't they have access to that so that they could see if anybody has collapsed unconscious in the room, somewhere in the house, in the bedroom? Or would they like access to the temperature sensors, assuming they're still working, to know which room is hottest so they might have an idea where is the fire primarily? That information could be life-saving. And yet you wouldn't want the fire department to have access to all that all the time. You only want them to have access to it in the circumstance that the house is on fire. The same argument could be made with the police department. The burglar alarm has gone off. The house has been penetrated. At least it thinks it's been broken into. It summons the police department. The police department are on the way. The same argument. They might want to get access to the webcams, among other things, but only under those conditions. So somehow we have to have the notion of episodic access, which is granted and revoked in some automatic or manual way. So how do we do that? I'm not sure anybody has actually solved that problem easily. Let's take another example, which is also troubling to me. What about the residents and the guests? So let me start with the residents. There are adults and there are kids. There may not be kids, but suppose you have a family and you have multiple parties living there, and some of them are kids. And as much as you love your kids, you don't want them to have access to all the controls of the house, especially the security system and everything else. But how does the system know that? I mean, if you use an oral interaction system, how does it know that it's the kid that's asking? And worse, what if you have guests and they come and you want them to control some part of the house, but not all of it? So how do you distinguish? And in fact, what is the ritual that you use to introduce your guests to the house so that while they're there, you know, they can flush the toilet or turn the lights on or whatever else it is? What if they're only there overnight? Or what if they're only there for the evening, but you still want them to be able to manipulate some portions of the house, but not necessarily everything? What is the mechanism for doing that? How hard is it to introduce them to the house or the house to them, and to say what is it that they can and cannot do? I mean, it's one thing to flip a switch to turn the lights on and off, and it's something else to have gone through a sacrifice a chicken over the CPU ritual in order to make sure that your guests can control the part of the house that they should have access to. What happens when they leave? Okay, you want to revoke those privileges. You don't want them messing around with the house when you're away. I submit to you that this problem of distinguishing privileges in an online environment like this is not a trivial matter. We've made experiments at Google on recognizing voices to try to distinguish who are the speakers, but I can assure you this is not as easy as it might sound. And so working in that space is not perfect. I'm of the reaching the conclusion that we probably should have multiple ways of getting the house to do what we want it to do in the residential setting, including simple flat panels, and maybe even a switch that turns on a light and turns it off. Wow, what an idea. I mean, it's possible that turning the switch off and on is not just a matter of breaking and making a circuit. It could be a signal which causes a whole bunch of different things to happen. So you could program the light switch to mean turn on these 16 light bulbs and certain configurations and mess with the dimmer. Make that a controllable, programmable thing. But your intent is very clear when you approach that one device, because you know which one it is and what sets of things it's supposed to control, as opposed to trying to argue with your artificially intelligent system about which light bulb you want to turn on. The shop floor, of course, is a whole other story. If you have an automated manufacturing plant with a lot of these devices in it, the administrative staff, the people who are handling finance and secretarial duties and everything else, should not be the ones messing around with machines on the shop floor. How many people, just out of sheer curiosity, have seen the YouTube video of the Tesla automated construction plant in Fremont? If you haven't seen it, you got to go look. Just say Tesla Fremont, you know, on YouTube. You'll see 160 robots assembling Tesla cars. I mean, this is awesome. It's just awesome. And yet, these things are physically powerful devices. The last thing you want is somebody messing around with those who don't know what they're doing. So this kind of access control thing and strong authentication of the parties who have access to and control over the devices or the data that's being gathered. Let me give you another example. Suppose, as I do, I have sensors in every room in the house, and they're sampling temperature, humidity, and light levels in every room in the house every 5 minutes. And these sensors are actually little store-and-forward radio devices. They form a mesh network. And when they're done gathering data, they send that data through the network to a server that I have down in the basement. I accumulate that over the course of a year. And at the end of the year, I have good engineering data about how well the heating and ventilation and air conditioning has worked. And I know, you know, only a geek would do that, but in fact, it's very useful engineering data. But now let's imagine that somebody is gathering that same data because I have made the system, it's penetrable, or I didn't encrypt the data. And so after 6 months or something, someone might get a pretty good idea of how many people live in the house, how often do they come and go, what are their diurnal patterns, which rooms do they occupy. That would be very useful if you plan to rob the house. So here's an example where data, which looked like it's pretty innocuous, turns out to be potentially hazardous because somebody could use it and infer things from it. And another reason for wanting to protect access in these kinds of situations. So standards turn out to be pretty important. Right now in the Internet of Things, there are a lot of different organizations, industry consortia, standards making organizations that are exploring different possible protocols for use in the Internet of Things, whether that's different kinds of radio protocols, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, Bluetooth low energy, 6LowPAN, 802.15.4. I mean, there are a lot of different bearing standards that are being considered. Then there are layers of protocol above that. Fortunately, most of them are thinking of using IP version 6, which has 128 bits of address space, so that should be enough to handle the predicted 50 to 100 billion devices over the course of the next few decades. But after that, when you get above that IPv6 layer, there is a lot of variation again, including up at the data level. How do I describe what the information is that the devices produce? How do I describe the commands that they're willing to respond to? How do I describe the access control mechanisms and the protocols for granting access to these devices? These vary all over the map. It's very important that we finally get to some commonality. The reason is that interoperability is conferred by agreeing on standards. That's why the internet lets you connect, you know, billions of devices to each other, because they all adopted the same protocols. We're nowhere close to that in this space right now. And we are going to have to explore the various ideas, because we will learn from them. Some of the ideas will work well and some won't, and sometimes that will be very visible. And the whole idea here is that we eventually move towards commonality. There will be resistance to that, because a lot of the manufacturers will hope that their devices will be the dominant ones, like, you know, the VHS versus Betamax. But it's not a good way to run a business. The best way to run a business is to try to make things interwork, because from your point of view, you want to buy from multiple brand suppliers, and you would like all that stuff to work together, as opposed to having different controllers and different apps for every possible brand. That's just impossible and very inconvenient. So there's a lot of stuff going on right now, and it's going to take a while to settle down. Another issue for me is the backward compatibility question. When people buy some of these devices, they expect them to last for a while. And it's almost certain that there will be evolution over time to new functionality as new versions of products are developed. But the last thing in the world you want is to have to go buy a whole new slew of devices because the support system has migrated on and it doesn't work with the old devices. I mean, consumers are really unhappy when they're forced to buy something that they didn't necessarily want because the old device worked well. So backward compatibility is another issue that needs to be taken care of. And I think there will be pressure on device makers over time to achieve commonality, standardization, backward compatibility, and the like. So finally, we get to some longer term questions. You probably may have some digital picture frames. I know I have a bunch of them. And I was pretty excited about them, really, because, you know, everybody in the family would take digital pictures with their mobiles, and they would upload the pictures to a website, and the picture frames would download the pictures from the website. And, you know, if you've got grandchildren, or if you have, you know, nieces and nephews and so on, the family sort of can tell you what's going on. You just get up in the morning and watch the picture frame, cycle through what's gone on in the recent past. Of course, that does remind me that the picture frame access control and security is important, because if somebody breaks into the website that has the pictures that you're uploading to the picture frame, the grandparents may see pictures of what they hope is not the grandchildren. So security becomes an important issue at home as well as at work. The problem is that my digital picture frames have these little, you know, AC-DC converters, and eventually they poop out. Even if the picture frame is okay, it's actually hard to find the AC-DC converter, especially if the company's gone out of business. And, you know, if you want to fuss around with a micrometer to figure out what's the right size of the plug to go in and whether it's positive or negative on the inside or the, I mean, it's a pain in the neck. And so I have a little stack of picture frames full of pictures that work just fine, except they don't have any power. And, you know, I'm going to have to retire before I can go find all the devices that I need, or maybe get somebody else to do that. There's a lot of other big problems, like storage corruption. Some of the picture frames have digital information, which is starting to fail. You have to replenish that. I have another problem. I've customized some of my entertainment system thinking, boy, you know, that's really cool. I got this, all this stuff together, except for one problem. Every time it breaks, which happens, you know, with some regularity, I have to call a guy up who lives 100 miles away and has to drive out and reprogram it. And you might say, well, you idiot, you know, go get the source code and fix it yourself. And the answer is, hey, I could get the source code, but do I have the time to go fuss around to fix it? So customization, as nice as it could be, can also turn out to be a real pain in the neck. So if you're going to think about how to customize the Internet of Things environment, you probably want to do it in a way that an ordinary mortal can manage the reconfiguration of the system. Another really good example, I've had some problems with the Wi-Fi system not working adequately with the entertainment system. And of course, at this point, you're down running around thinking you're going to have to run Wireshark to look at the TCP/IP exchanges to figure out why the protocols don't work. That is not my favorite activity either. I have programmable light switches too, except that these are the things that plug right into where the light switch would normally go. And so they're local, they have little batteries and tiny, tiny little font, you know, and when the battery fails, you have to reprogram the light switch. And so I'm sitting there, you know, cursing, I won't repeat any of that, as I put the new battery in, the thing restarts, and then I have to reprogram everything and with a magnifying glass. And, so the right thing to do there would be to replace those with something that you could at least see. But that's a big pain. And in fact, the battery issue is one I also wanted to emphasize for you. I wear two hearing aids. I carry a little, that's why I wear a three-piece suit. I have a place to put my hearing aids in my pocket. These little batteries are the only reason these $4,000 hearing aids work. So without the battery, they're just, you know, a pile of electronics. If the guys that make these batteries decide someday that, yeah, it's not a good business, the hell with it, my hearing aids don't work anymore. And so I'm completely dependent on people producing this particular battery, the particular format, and particular voltage level. And if they decide not to, I'm in deep doo-doo. So there's an example of a supply chain dependency that you sometimes forget about. You know, you pay a lot of money for a particular thing, but it's dependent on some little tiny thing that isn't made anymore, and then foof. So I just discovered a similar problem with my old VHS players, which I never use, except I have hundreds of these VHS tapes, and one day I thought, maybe I should look at them to see, you know, whether they're worth keeping. So I get the VHS tape out, plug it in, and the first thing that happens is click, 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 blat. And I said, what's that? You know, I open it up, and it turns out there's this little rubber band thing that drives the tape, and it broke, because it just gave up after a while. You know, rubber doesn't last forever. And nobody makes that particular model anymore. And you know, I tried to hack it with a rubber band, that didn't work. So now I have a little stack of broken VHS players and a big pile of VHS tapes with no idea what's on them. So another good example of how you can end up depending on something very simple, like a rubber band, only having it not replaceable and not workable. So we should be really thinking about stuff like that, because we're going to inherit these problems. We're the ones that are going to buy this equipment. And so to the extent that any of you are responsible for designing and building this stuff, it's going to be your fault if you don't like it. So, you know, you're here to learn about stuff like that, and I'm here to remind you that there's work to be done to make these things habitable. This is the last slide. So these are just things I want to emphasize as I close. One of them that I tell my engineers is that the most important thing you can do with the Internet of Things is make the devices reliable. Because if they're not reliable, nobody is going to want them. They won't want to depend on them. I mean, if the light goes off and on 85% of the time, that's not good enough. And frankly, the first time it doesn't go on, you'll be really unhappy about that. Ease of use also, you could tell this entire theme of this talk today is all about the complexity of configuring these things and managing them and access controlling them and everything else. We have to make that simple. By the way, it's probably a good idea to make them safe too. Why would anybody buy a device if they thought it was going to be unsafe? So one thing to pay a lot of attention to is convincing people that the device you make is safe. Now, if you're the maker of the device, why would anybody believe you when you say, it's safe because we tested it? You're going to have third parties like the Underwriters Laboratory or something else to make sure that these devices are in fact safe. Now, remember, these are programmable devices. This means they're full of software. Anybody that makes assertions about the safety of software, you know, deserves what they get. So we need to have a cyber underwriters laboratory that actually looks at the software and says something about whether it has malware in it or whether it has made mistakes in terms of the way in which it functions. Security and privacy, I've already hinted at the problem of privacy. Security is a similar issue. For example, the temperature sensors and the possibility of exposing someone, a criminal, someone with criminal intent to information that would allow them to carry out their nefarious act. Autonomy is something that is often not considered. Everybody is so fascinated with, wow, look what you can do through the internet. I mean, yeah, you can, I've got this app and I can do these crazy things. I'll tell you whether the front door is open or closed or whether the oven is still on. This is really cool. Then one day your house gets disconnected from the internet and it stops working. This is not a good design. So what people need to do is to think their way through, what happens if the internet isn't available? Does the house still work? Does the manufacturing plant still work? The answer had better be yes, because if the answer is no, you can be pretty sure that people will say, I don't want to have anything to do with that anymore. And so I have to remind everybody that no matter what interfaces you build to let you interact with the cloud or your mobile through the cloud, you need to build interfaces inside with some kind of local capability that more or less look the same, so that you can still run the house or run the manufacturing plant, even if the internet isn't available. And finally, the interoperability part. I think that's, I want to overemphasize that because we will have many different manufacturers from many different places around the world making these things. And the last thing you want is to have different control systems and different apps to control each separate device or each different brand of device. This was the situation when the internet was built. When it was designed in 1973, we had the IBM SNA network, we had the Digital Equipment Corporation DECnet, and we had the Hewlett-Packard DS system. Their computers could be networked. So it wasn't like there was no networking, and there was the ARPANET. But you couldn't get the IBM machines to talk to the DEC machines or the HP machines, and IBM and DEC and HP liked that. They said, you want network computers? Just buy our brand, end of story. But eventually, people discovered that there was this internet thing, and it made different brands of computers talk to each other, and so they said, we don't want to buy your stuff if it doesn't run TCP/IP, because if it runs TCP/IP, I can talk to IBM, Digital, HP, and others. And that's, I hope, going to happen with the IoT, Internet of Things, that people, will, you and me, will demand commonality and interoperability so we can actually make ensembles of devices work. That's all I have to say about this, but I'm happy to answer questions. And in any case, thanks very much for joining me this afternoon.
My question, since this is a business school, is you talked about, you know, artificial intelligence and what it might do. We've all, you know, can list off jobs that are going to go away, from almost everything automotive related to customer service. What jobs do you see being created, or what industries do you see being created?
So, thank you. That's a very good question. In fact, let me make a little advertisement for a group that I've been working with for the last 3 years now. It's called I4J. If you go to i4j.info, it's innovation for jobs, and we're asking the same question. We know that jobs are created by new technology and innovation. We also know they're destroyed. You can see this in the original Industrial Revolution, where there were people who, you know, had huge battles about, you know, you're automating the weaving business, you're automating the wool production business, and we hate that, and so they would go and destroy manufacturing plants and things. Historically, what has happened is that new jobs are created. Now, clearly, somebody has to write the software, somebody has to build the devices, somebody has to maintain the devices, and with regard to the Internet of Things, I predict that there will be a bunch of new jobs created for people who will come and configure your stuff for you because you couldn't figure it out. And that's not necessarily the best outcome, but it does create work. Bugs also create work, by the way, but I don't recommend putting the bugs in to create work. I mean, we've been worried about the antivirus guys actually creating viruses so that their antivirus can detect them and fix you and all that stuff. So there are going to be jobs that are created as a consequence of these advanced devices. When you think about robots, for example, think about other automated manufacturing environments. We've been through this many times before. I mean, instead of a glass blower to blow every bottle that you need for milk, for example, you have machines that make those bottles. or wine bottles, et cetera. And yet we still have a significant industry. There are people who have to run those things, have to build, design, and operate the machines. It's one thing which is really critical, though, is to understand that because the jobs have gone away and there are people who are available to work on new jobs, will they be capable of working on new jobs? Now, that raises a really interesting question about retraining. And it actually raises a more extended question, and that has to do with the fact that we are living longer on the average. It used to be that if you retired at age 65, you probably had a few years left after that. So retirement made sense at age 65. With people living into their 80s and 90s, retirement at age 65 is kind of odd in a way, because it might be 25 years of what do I do now. More important, this longevity says that it's not good enough to go to school for 20 years and expect to work for 70, even if you want to. So now suddenly there is a, I have to keep learning all during the course of my career. And usually that doesn't mean drop everything and go back to school full time. So we are going to be, we are entering into a society where learning is becoming increasingly important throughout your lifetime. And I guess if there was any one thing that you'd want your kids to grow up with, one of them is the ability and desire to learn new things. And the other one is to apply critical thinking. And this latter point, although I'm drifting away from the main theme here, it seems to me very important, because kids are going to be confronted by all kinds of misinformation, some of it deliberate, some of it by accident, and certainly in the internet, and most recently with the spate of fake news and alternative facts and all that. Oh my God. Critical thinking is your friend here. Where did this come from? What's the source? You know, what makes, why should I believe this? We want our children to learn those skills so that they will be able to distinguish useful material from useless material. And it's not just on the internet. I mean, you get misinformation from books, magazines, movies, newspapers, television, radio, etc., your friends, your parents, and others. And so learning to distinguish is important. But to come back to the main theme, I'm convinced that careers have to be built around expecting to learn new things and maybe even changing careers several times in the course of a lifetime. So I'm actually fairly confident that there would be plenty of work, as there always has been, but that we have to train people to do that new work. Okay, other questions?
Hi, my name is Titus. We met earlier. So last year, you wrote an article on the fragmentation of the internet, but I was wondering specifically what you thought of data fragmentation through the internet. So my background, as I said before, is in AI and machine learning, and obviously data is super crucial in that field, but things are very siloed right now as it is, right? So like Facebook has a lot of data, Twitter has a lot of data, everyone has a lot of data, but it's very hard to cross those bridges, and that would have huge implications on, you know, serving up products and services to consumers that are actually individualized, obviously national security, understanding societal trends, political trends, et cetera.
So let me make sure that I've understood the question. That you're asking about the silos of data that, in fact, are hard to make commensurate or hard to integrate in a useful way.
Yes, exactly.
Okay. And this is, by the way, the intelligence community has exactly that problem. But so does the business community. When you think about the kind of information you might be able to accumulate about the use of your products, for example, or feedback from consumers, sometimes that data accumulates in different piles, and the semantics of the data may not be understood well enough to make them compatible. Now, at Google, we spend a lot of time trying to assimilate and build tools for assimilating large quantities of information and allowing people to correlate it. And so one of our applications was called Big Table, and that's been succeeded by something called Spanner. And those are freely available to people who want to build large-scale data systems. But you still have exactly the problem you were describing. It has to do with semantics. Coming to the Internet of Things in particular, this is a big issue, because if each of the manufacturers has a different word for a descriptor for the parameters of the light bulb, and what does dim and high mean, or what number do you, how do you express the color, how do you express the illumination factor, and you can make this up for all kinds of other devices. How do you get them to work together? And so now we're back to this semantic thing, There is an organization, an informal organization called schema.org. It's a not-for-profit group. They're working on and allowing people to use their tools to create exactly the kind of ontologies that you need in order to make this stuff commensurate. And so at least there's an attempt to address that problem. But you really have to work at it. Otherwise, the semantics just falls apart. Sir.
Thank you so much for speaking. My name is Doug Waters, and I have one question regarding IoT and its expansion to developing economies. So there are some areas in the world, such as Haiti or sub-Saharan Africa, that might not all have access to electrical infrastructure.
Right.
So how will IoT take off in these areas if they might not be able to charge a device? And I guess more specifically, what are the first steps needing to be taken?
Okay, so let's take Haiti for an example, because there's a huge object lesson there, which is well beyond just the Internet of Things and the power problem. They destroyed their entire forested region of Haiti because using it to burn for fuel to cook. And so that's a deforested region. All kinds of bad things happen as a result of that. The Dominican Republic, which is the other half of the island, did not do that, and it's in much better shape. So first of all, the easiest answer to your question may turn out to be solar power. And I don't want that to sound glib, and it is not. There's an organization called the Solar Electric Light Fund. It's run by a good friend of mine, Bob Frayling. Bob started out by providing 100-watt solar panels to light a light bulb in places where everything was dark when the sun went down, except maybe for an oil lamp or a candle or something. But he's graduated over the course of the last 25 years to building solar-powered hospitals, some of which he's put into Haiti. So solar power is a possible answer to that. The local generation of power is a very attractive idea, and we're starting to see our power industry here in the US is starting to recognize that instead of having gigantic plants and distribution networks, which are subject to failure because of storms and other kinds of, or even deliberate sabotage, having microgrids, small generation capability, whether it's the house by itself or a small neighborhood, may turn out to be a much more efficient way of doing things. In addition to which, if you guys have read Ted Koppel's book called Lights Out, if you haven't, it's a little hypey, but it's very important. He points out that the kinds of power generation equipment that we have today involve 100-ton, multi-100-ton devices. First of all, it's not clear if one of them fails that there's even a way to move a new one to the destination. I mean, it's a big, heavy thing. So you'd have to assemble it on the spot. Second, they're designed for a particular location. So this is not off-the-shelf stuff. We don't have a warehouse full of 300-ton generators. We just don't. If, on the other hand, we were to build smaller-sized power systems, you could standardize that. The interfaces would be the same. All the power conversion and everything else. So some standardization and change of scale could turn out to be very helpful in addressing this power question. So I'm a big fan of alternative energy. Now, one final point on this, otherwise I'll just go on forever, which is what old Stanford professors tend to do. Maybe they do it here too at Lynn at UCLA. Yeah, he says yes, that's a problem. Thank you. So the sun doesn't shine all the time on the planet. It shines all the time elsewhere, but we don't see it all the time. So solar power is episodic. Wind power is episodic. The question is, what do you do about that? The answer is storage. So we need really good storage technology in order to harvest the energy when it's available, store it away, and then use it when it's needed. By the way, this is like packet switching. If you think about the way the telephone system was designed, it's a circuit switch network, and if you're using it for data, the speed in has to be the same as the speed out because there's no place to put the bits, right? They just go along the wire at whatever rate you're pumping them. So if the guy on the receiving end can't take them at the rate that the generator is making them, it doesn't work. Enter packet switching, thanks to Lynn and others. And you take the data in at a gigabit per second, you got a packet full of this stuff and it comes in, bam, really fast. And it goes through the network at some rate, and then it lands over here where it is stored while it piddles out the other end at the 9.6 kilobit thing over there. Now, there is an overall flow control issue, which Lynn and Van Jacobsen have sorted through. But the idea is that storage was important. So we need the ability to store power. DC may be the best way to deal with this stuff, not AC. And so you're starting to see a renovation of the power industry in the DC space. It used to be that, you know, DC power was a terrible idea because you lose energy as you pump it along. Now people are recognizing that DC may be a very good idea, and I'm sure Mr. Edison is happy to hear that up there, because George Westinghouse is the one that pushed AC, and Edison was pushing DC, and it didn't work out. Okay, so DC power, episodic power, solar power, and small size grids are part of the answer to the problem. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Vint. It's great to see you again. It was great talking to you earlier, and thanks again for coming to speak with us
today. Yeah, we haven't seen each other for the last 35 minutes. It's amazing.
My name is Sophia Law, for those in the room, and I'm a second year full-time MBA. I wanted to ask you more about IoT in the broader sense. So you focused in your presentation a lot about consumer products and, you know, like stuff in the home, for example.
Right.
Industrial, environmental, local, state, and federal applications are arguably more greater scale. So, I mean, average consumers in this day and age are, you know, more likely to adopt these new products, but I would say that government tends to move slower, and apologies to anyone in the room who's working for government companies, but they tend to be slower to adopt new technologies. What do you think needs to happen with government, with local and state and federal? What policies, what legislators need to happen in order for to enable this adoption across mm-hmm. cities and across states across the world?
So a couple of thoughts come to mind right away. First of all, in the industrial setting, by the way, a lot of the problems I was describing may be more solvable because you will probably have experts who are there trying to assemble and manage and operate these IoT-like devices. So I feel slightly better in the industrial setting than I do in the residential setting where you don't have your IT manager right there on call. On the government side, the government is rarely able to adopt these kinds of technologies in order to demonstrate their utility. On the other hand, governments can sometimes adopt policies that will encourage the adoption. So as an example, if you buy a Tesla, you get a $7,500 break on your taxes because it's recognized that pollution-free stuff is an important contribution to our environment. So the policy tries to match that. I can imagine governments at all levels deciding to adopt policies that provide incentive for certain kinds of things to happen. There's a life lesson hiding in your question. It has to do with recognizing that you don't like a situation, you don't like the outcome of something. And instead of railing about not liking the outcome, the thing you need to do is to analyze the incentives that led to that outcome and then ask, how do I change the incentives? That's the solution to solving a lot of problems, is reinventing incentives that lead in the direction that you want to go. People will follow incentives if they're given the opportunity. So I think government in this case is more likely to win in a lot of these areas by creating incentives for the use of these devices. Now, let's also point out, with all the problems that I tried to outline, that there has to be an incentive to protect people from the potential hazards of poorly done Internet of Things devices. And so that's another incentive that has to be in place so that the consumers will feel protected in the event that things don't work the way they should. So that's sort of, you know, a rather broad brush response to the issue that you're raising. Yes, sir.
Hi there. Could you please share your thoughts on today's WikiLeaks release?
I'm sorry, on which? On
Did you see what happened with WikiLeaks?
Yeah. Well, I honestly haven't read all of, read the headlines, but I haven't seen the actual algorithms and the software that purports to be tools that are used for hacking. I looked at some of the other stuff that was reported earlier from WikiLeaks, from Snowden, and some of it was pretty cool, actually. I mean, those hacks are impressive. I've considered my job is to make the hacker's job harder. Including the government guys, and then I even had an opportunity to go tell them that. I was over at NSA last year, meeting with a group that does that sort of thing, and I told them that point blank that my purpose in life was to make their job harder. Unfortunately, there's so much software out there that is broken, and it's partly our fault, right? You know, we're not good about updating things, and you know, we get lazy. That's one of the reasons that cloud computing has turned out to be a helpful thing, because at least you can change everything all at the same time in the cloud, as opposed to waiting for everybody to take time to upload new software into their laptops and their mobiles. But I think your real question is, am I happy or unhappy about the release of that stuff?
Yeah, and you know, what are the ramifications for our country?
Well, the first problem, obviously, is that if those tools are still useful, then we are at risk, because a lot of bad guys are going to use those tools that they might not have known existed. There is a flip side to that, and the exploits that those tools enable, this you can't run away from seeing that there is a risk factor, and you now have an obligation and responsibility to go fix the bugs that allow those tools to work. So in some sense, you can make the argument that the exposure might ultimately result in a safer environment, but perhaps not before a lot of damage gets done. The fact of release, I mean, we could argue over if it's classified and, you know, should they do that or not. But the fact of the release means that we are now sensitized to the existence of those tools. And so shame on us if we don't do something about protecting ourselves and our customers, for example, against exactly the abuse of those things.
So I'm Andrew Robinson. I'm the president of Storage Innovations, and I was interested in asking your opinion on what you think the importance of geo-distributed storage is to the future, in particular notions of cloud RAID, where you solve the cybersecurity challenge by distributing the storage to many sites, and you also fix the redundancy challenge, and you also address the ability to locate your storage in regions where energy is perhaps generated on site, or green or carbon-free.
Okay, so that's a fairly, you know, you want this in 25 words or less, right? So first of all, distributed storage, we rely on very heavily at Google, as you probably know. We have multiple data centers, and we distribute the data, shard the data into pieces, and scatter it across all the data centers in the hope that if a whole data center goes down, we have all the data elsewhere. So that's one thing that we rely on. I will say, though, that there is an extension of that. It's called locks, which is lots of copies keep things safe. Maybe not. It depends on where you put them and whether or not the place where you put them is being maintained or not. I mean, you know, if it's your hard drive at home, I'm not convinced, because I don't know anything about your normal habits, about how well do you keep the data updated? Do you copy it anyplace else? What about the safety and security of the data? Is it encrypted? We encrypt everything. But it's with keys that we can manage. Now, if you encrypt everything, you're welcome to encrypt stuff and send it to Google, for example, and we will put it away as this encrypted blob, and we'll give it back to you when you ask for it. And if you say, but I don't have the key anymore, can you help me? The answer is no. And so there are a bunch of side effects of trying to be safe and secure and private that are occasioned by using cryptography, for example, as a tool for protection. So for all of you business folks here who think somehow that safety and security translate into crypto, you would be wrong. It's helpful, and it's important, and it's a tool for strong authentication as well as integrity protection and confidentiality, but it's not easy to manage. And it's particularly hard for folks like you and me to manage a whole bunch of different keys, just like it's a pain to manage a whole bunch of passwords. So I won't go into that rant particularly, except that trying to get rid of passwords is a good idea. Two-factor authentication is a good idea. Some people think that biometrics are a good idea. Not so clear. You know, if somebody, you know, your fingerprints get digitized. And so if you have a fingerprint reader, the thing that it's actually getting is not the fingerprint, but a digitized filtered version of it. And it compares that with what it got before. And if it matches, it says, you know, that's your finger. What happens if somebody actually gets the data that is your digital representation of your finger? I mean, do you cut your finger off because it's no longer a suitable authenticator? No. And so there, you need to have more than just the biometrics, I think, in order to make it work.
The formula, a brokered security manager, which was also distributed as a service, would that change things perhaps on the security?
Well, and of course, I would interpret this as blockchain. And now, let me distinguish Bitcoin from blockchain for just a second. Bitcoin is based on a blockchain idea. When people say, what do you think of Bitcoin? I run away, because I really am not convinced that the Bitcoin idea is actually very workable. It's very attractive for people who want to have anonymous transactions. On the other hand, it doesn't fulfill its promise as a fully distributed anonymous system, because First of all, the Bitcoin mining has turned into a giant enterprise, right? People pouring huge amounts of money into engines doing the Bitcoin mining. It's not really distributed at all. You end up with... On the other hand, the blockchain idea is interesting. And there are some applications of it now. IBM, for example, is pursuing this. Google has a few little applications related to blockchain. There are some scaling issues associated with it that I want to be very careful to point out, that it isn't obvious yet that the blockchain algorithms will scale, you know, infinitely. But for certain kinds of applications, permissioned blockchains, that is to say, you know who the parties are and you have reason to trust them, then the blockchain idea does provide you with visibility and with replicability, because you have multiple copies of the blockchain. So in that case, that's a potentially useful tool. It doesn't solve all problems, but it can be helpful. Thank you all.